again. It is 10:30 a.m. Again, it's April 9, 2019, and we're moving on to item number 13. All members of the court are present, and the Commissioner's Court is back in session. Item number 13 is a workshop to discuss elections with all officials involved in the administration of elections and voter registration in Hardin County. This was a request that was made some months back, and we agreed to hold a workshop in the spring. And it is springtime now because everybody's coughing and sniffling and everything else. But we wanted to, we know that there are some issues that both parties have that they wanted to bring to the attention of the Commissioner's Court with elections so that we could work towards resolving issues such as machines that may need to be replaced. Or we also talked about the option of going back to paper ballots. So anyway, that is something that we'll talk about today along with any other item that Ms. Austin, Ms. Cook, or her staff, and both party chairs and any other precinct chair who is here today that would like to talk about anything regarding elections. What I'll ask you to do, anybody that wants to speak, please raise your hand and I'll recognize you and call you up to the podium so that everything that we say gets into one of these microphones and that we get it on the record. Anybody sitting on the front row, there's a microphone here. If you just kind of slide close to the microphone, that'll be fine, but it would probably be best if we come up to the podium and speak. So at this time, I will turn it over to Lisa Finn, who wants to read a statement from Ms. Cook regarding a letter that she addressed to the Commissioner's Court. Ms. Finn?
To the members of the Hardin County Commissioner's Court, please accept my apologies for not attending this very important meeting. Our mother is in the hospital and is having heart procedure today. Lisa Finn and Debbie Yancey are ready to answer any questions concerning voter registration. Respectfully, Shirley Cook.
Thank you, Ms. Finn. And our prayers are with Ms. Cook, Judge Brewer, and their mother. Hope that everything goes well with her procedure today. I know she's been in the hospital for quite some time. So we have some questions that were submitted ahead of time from Ms. Breckel and from Ms. Perez. And I guess what I'll do at this time is just kind of turn it over to each of the party chairs and let's go through each item and see what we can and cannot resolve today. I anticipate this will be a first of maybe a couple of workshops that we'll have to have regarding this, but the plan is to bring items to the Commissioner's Court that's going to cost money to the county so that we can try to work on those during our budget workshops, which will take place in the June-July timeframe. We want to make sure that we, any funds that need to be spent to make sure that we're prepared for the next major elections, which will take place in 2020, that we are ready for those and can resolve all or as many issues as we can. Depending on what we can and cannot afford. So who would like to go first?
Well, I only have one thing to say along with this list, but if I can address something to begin with.
Sure. Good morning, Mr. Batman.
Good morning, Judge, Commissioners.
Good morning.
People of Hardin County. working elections, I'd say just about 90% of the time when we have a slowdown, when we have a problem with people standing in line, difficulty
consensus from everybody here on both parties?
Yes.
Yes.
Well, that might make it real easy. Well, I've told y'all before, my wife has never voted electronic. She said if we ever take away paper ballots, she's gonna be mad. And I can't have that.
They call her the smart McDane.
Something like that.
Mr. Baffin, going back to what you said about the statute, and Miss, our county clerk might can, tell me this. I think the statute says you have to have one for handicap, is that correct? Even though you do have paper?
And there will be one. We have Hart, we have John Thompson here from Hart Intercivics, and if y'all, if you have a question, about something like that, he could help you.
I guess my question would be, if this court decided that Hardin County's gonna go strictly paperless, are we required to have at least?
You mean paper?
Paper, I'm sorry. Are required to have at least one electronic for handicap, is that correct?
Yes, yes, but that is possible.
Per polling?
Yeah, at each polling location.
Okay, currently, we have that, have we had any problems with those machines? Has anybody, I don't remember a problem with the mobile machine that you bring out to the car, is there?
Yes, yes, that is saying.
I tell you that, there has been a problem with this.
Yeah, it's been a lot of trouble with those, but it's just, they're old. They're old.
Okay, they're antiquated, so there's probably a new updated version of that that's not as much of a problem, but I also have to say that.
Do they have to be electronic, or can we take a paper ballot out to the car?
I was gonna say, before this bill, we used to take paper ballots out.
Do you know, John?
Yeah, so, you can do either. There's no law saying that it has to be electronic to take out to the car. You can still take a paper ballot out to the car. The law says that you have to have accessible device in the polling location. With the new system, upgrade system, we do have an accessible device that produces a paper ballot. So
1.1.
Oh, okay, so what are we talking about, saving 800,000?
It's still a big deal.
The original quote that was given, it'll be less than that, because the original quote was given was electronic during early voting, so you're gonna have less devices, so it's gonna be probably under $1 million if y'all go 100% paper. If you do central scanning, like you said, I mean, you can do that. I'm just saying, here are the differences. We offer everything up to the county to decide, but here are the differences between each one, and it's up to y'all to make that, that decision.
We'll sit down, looks like Vicki has.
No, my questions mainly pertain to the county clerk to give us a report.
Can you come up, Ms. Breckler?
Oh.
Yes, ma'am.
No, I don't want to.
Thank you.
Good morning, Ms. Breckler.
Exactly. Thank you all for being open to have this discussion today. I appreciate it.
Yes, ma'am.
My questions were mainly focused around, or maybe I called it a report for lack of a better terminology, from Glenda to tell us about the condition of the voting equipment as it stands right now. Even with the using only paper ballots, which I agree with, we still have the problem of the paper ballot scanners that in this last election created huge chaos. So my question is, how dependent and how dependable are these, the vote scanners, the ballot scanners?
The new ones, is that what you're
talking about? Are we going to buy new ones?
I think we're talking about the possibility of buying new ones.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. I think the decision would be whether or not we buy one central scanner or have enough to put at each of the polling locations. And my opinion is if we can swing it, we should have one at each polling location.
Exactly. Because like you said, we would be here till 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
That's the way it used to be, but hopefully Hardin County can move past that and stay in the
yes, ma'am.
Right. And the other, when would you know, when would the commissioner's court make a decision as to whether or not y'all are going to purchase these new ballot scanners?
At the very latest, it would be the end of August, before we adopt our new budget. We adopt the new budget in September. My proposed budget would be ready by the end of July, and I'm hoping that we have a decision made by then, but if for some reason we don't, we would have a decision made by the end of August.
Is that a real possibility that we might can purchase these scanners?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, excellent. And the other question I had, which is mainly directed to Glenda, a statement from the county clerk regarding the e-poll books. I keep hearing that they're obsolete, we can't use them anymore. And the specific question is, should we prepare election workers to use the original paper list of voters that we used a long time ago, which really slows down the process?
That would be up to the court if we purchase the new e-pads or poll pads.
E-poll books.
John, would that price include new e-poll books?
Yes, I can work it all in together. Okay, I can put it all in together.
Now, is that still putting us under $1 million?
It will. I can get it under $1 million. And then we also have 0% interest financing with a payment in arrears.
Now, if I remember right, when we were talking about going all electronic, that was the bid that came in at 1.1. But at one time, I think Glenda may have talked to you about going all paper with new poll pads and what have you, and that was about half that price.
It is.
Okay.
It is. It's about half the price. Usually, all paper.
Yes.
All right.
They have to be. My other questions pertain to the process of voter registration in Hardin County specifically. How many applications have been rejected for lack of proof of citizenship, and exactly what is that process? When one turns in their voter registration application to the voter registrar's office, what safeguards are in place that
sense that we know there's 17, I think they're still trying to work it out at the Secretary of State's office. Because at the beginning of the session, they asked for the Secretary of State to resign based on those numbers.
I'm aware of that.
Which came from DPS. And if you want to research it, you can go online to,
I've already done it. Thank you, though. Debbie.
On my application, you know, it also asks the question, are you a US citizen? So if they check no, then they're supposed to stop. If it continues in the question 9, it's still
central counting station, and we pray to God we never go back to that. If we can get scanners at each polling site, the same type of system that we have now where we can bring the computer cards back in the evening, it does make the whole evening go much quicker, and that's my two cents. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
The smoke comes out, there's not much hope for it. Yes, we have had scanners that have broken down in the past, and I'm not sure that we have spare scanners to bring out. So our equipment is just so antiquated that it just needs to go on and...
I have a list of how many's broken and how many's, yeah.
And just so everybody knows, about 3 years ago, I think it was, Glenda had brought it to the court's attention about issues with the machines, and what we had asked was for her to have those evaluated to see if they could be fixed or what have you. And so she was headed to a conference in Austin anyway. She took all the machines that were having problems. Those that could be fixed were fixed and brought back. Some of those worked great after they were fixed, and some of those did not. And so I think that's why we're here today, is to determine how to proceed forward, determine how much it's gonna cost to do so, and with everybody being on the same page as far as being ready and willing to go to paper-only ballots, I think that's actually what we have talked about up here before, is the possibility of doing that and how much it would cost us to do so. Knowing that everybody here is in agreement with doing that is very helpful. And I think the next step is to ask Mrs. Austin to work with the purchasing agent and acquire some proposals so that we have those ready for our budget workshops, and try to plan for that so that we have the new machines in time, that the training takes place, and that they're ready for the primaries in 2020. That's my thoughts, and I think it's also the same thoughts as the rest of the members of the court.
I do have one more. I guess it's my next two cents.
Yes, ma'am. Ms. Perry.
We do have smaller precincts with, I'll put it gently, older voters, and none of the voters will use the electronic machines.
Yeah.
But there's two that I can just name off the top of my head that no voters will use the electronic machines. They definitely want paper.
And that's what Mrs. Austin has reported to us in the past. That and you know, at one time about 3 years ago, when another gentleman from Hardin come in, he was trying to, we wanted to see it so that somebody could go to any polling place in the county and vote. Well, the only way to do that is to go all electronic. So we started talking like that, and that's when I made the comment about my wife said if we ever do that, she won't vote anymore, and I'll be in the doghouse. So she's not the only one that feels that way. I think there's probably about 60% of the voters in Hardin County feel that way, and that's when we stopped talking about that altogether.
Here is my next question. If we were to go to, say, like they have it in Jefferson County, where you can go to any liquor store and vote, if you want to, aren't you required to be on the internet to have everything interfaced together? A central network, and I'm really against that. I just want you to know that.
The electronic poll books that check voters in will be required to be on the internet if you go to vote centers where you can vote anywhere. The reason being is you have to be able, they have to be able to talk to each other. Mm-hmm. So if I go to vote center check in and vote, I can't go, you know, 10 minutes down the road and do the same thing. So that's...
Well, if we go to strictly paper ballots, you'll have to vote in your polling place. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
Unless you have, you know, two precincts that are consolidated in one place.
Right.
But that doesn't change anything.
Great. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Regarding that, though...
Can I get your name?
My name is Cindy Disky.
Can you come up to the podium?
Oh.
Good morning.
Good morning, everybody.
My thing was
good idea to larger polling places if we could do that.
Yeah, that'd be good.
And I'm at the same precinct she is.
Yes, ma'am.
We had parking problems.
Yes, I was directing parking.
Yeah, she was out directing traffic, and I'm sure there were people parking across the street and down the road, and I'm sure some people just turned around and went home, you know.
This is at precinct 18.
Okay, yes, ma'am.
I did have to go down to the police department and get cones and all that, and so I learned how to do parking enforcement. Thank you. So, that's all, that's what I wanted.
There's not a lot of parking at precinct 18.
Do we wanna talk about maybe another location for 18?
Church of Christ? Is it the Church of Christ?
Yes. Well, Petrus is not a lot of parking either, so.
There's not much room there either, yeah.
Hopefully during redistricting, we can take some of them voters out of 18.
100%.
Yep.
When is redistricting?
Ma'am?
When is redistricting?
2021. Yeah. Won't be long.
You can't have 18.
You wanna be on the committee?
Judge, are we gonna consolidate?
Yes, we can do that.
They've got problems like that, what's best to do is split some of the precincts up, additional voting precinct.
Yeah, Commissioner Pelt was talking about at, like at 18, where there's not enough parking, what about either finding another location or splitting that up? Maybe having two locations, or what can we do to alleviate that? Does anybody have any recommendations?
I was speaking back to the previous comment.
Yes, ma'am.
Janet Hardin, precinct 7, first fall precinct. And if there was information when people first walked in, I guess this would have came to that.
Can we get you to come to the podium so we can get it on the record? Thank you.
Janet Hardin, precinct 7, we're a small precinct, but this, if, addressing the issue of people not being in the proper precinct, if there was information for people to see when they walked in, they wouldn't have to be in line, that they could check to see if they were in the right precinct. And I know we've had like just a map sometimes, but not always, but people need to be able to figure that out. Where are they supposed to vote?
Yeah.
And where do they need to go to vote? I mean, if we had some kind of whatever.
A lot of times they have no clue where they.
Right, they have no clue where to go. And that would help a lot for people would not to have to get in line, not to have to wait.
Right.
That would help in some kind of way, figure that out. Concerning the paper ballot scanners, last election, we had lots of new people. Usually we know everybody that comes in, but there were so many people voting on that day that I had never seen. And people walk up, and these are younger people than before, not just the, you know, a lot of the older voters that we all know. And they said, we are not voting on a machine. They were very adamant. More and more people are wanting paper. They want a record of their vote. They all want paper, I mean, most of them. But I think personally also that we need a scanner at each precinct, because to me that ensures more security. Because if you just took them all to the courthouse, who knows between that location and the courthouse, someone can get lost, your car can break down. But at least you've got something to, on that little disc, that each one would be more secure and you would know where there was a problem, if you found a machine, whatever else.
Well, I like the idea, if there's a problem with the ballot, the voter finds out when they go to scan it.
Exactly.
I think that's best that it happens at the polling place. And they scan it themselves, and then it's locked up, and the device comes here to be counted. I agree with that.
Yeah, like on this e-scan, when you put your ballot in, it shows a flag. And you know, I always tell them, don't walk away till you see a flag.
Yeah.
Then if there's a problem, go ahead.
Right.
That was an excellent point that was made just a while ago about the voters standing in line, big long line, find out they're at the wrong precinct when they go all the way through it. Is the, can the voter roll, remember we used to do the paper voter rolls?
Yes.
You know, all registered voters were on that
guess I didn't understand what you was talking about, Kent, but don't you have to have a voter's registration card to vote?
No, you have a driver's license, and most people do now.
You have to have picture ID.
When you get up there, again, we used to have stacks of books that we would page through and make sure that they're in that list. If we're still accessing or could do multiple hard copies, then more people could access it. And they could do that while they're waiting or doing something else, unless everybody's gonna do like Robin and go out and check them for them. And all we gotta do is have a Robin in every precinct.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm Sherry Williams. I'm from Sour Lake. I have just two things. One, this is probably not anything you can do, but if you can carry this back to Austin, I'd really appreciate it. I have what was addressed to me during the last election is there are blind people who do not want to use that electronic machine carried out there. They want the right to have the same as everybody else has with a paper ballot. They want their paper ballot in Braille. So it's something that maybe we can address for the future because it really was a big issue with a couple people. Okay, second thing I wanted to tell you about is the is something that I've noticed because I do work the polls too, so I do notice this, that we've had a lot of issue with people that live really close to each other, even a husband and wife, and they're actually, their registration is in two different precincts, so, you know, they'll come to us and one of them can vote there and the other one can't, and it's usually, more often than not, it happens like 15 and 14, and I mean, we're 15, so it happens 15 and 14 and 17, and they'll be on the highway and across the street from each other, neighbors. One votes one place, one votes the other place. We've had really big issues with that. I think we, you know, we keep handing out address statements and statement of address and things trying to get it fixed, but it is a real big issue. So it's something that we probably need to address as far as making sure our registration is actually getting these people that are in the same family or the neighbors registered in the same place because, you know, if they come at the last minute, then there they are in the wrong precinct. So, and also I will just say about the e-poll books, I don't know how anybody else feels, but this is my personal opinion. I love the e-poll book. And the reason I do like it is because it does tell you, and it's easy to say, look on your registration card and it tells you what precinct you need to be in and this, that, and the other and all that. But we have so many people that don't bring their voter registration card and you have their driver's license. When you're in a small precinct like I am, I can pretty well tell them where they need to vote based on their address because I pretty well know, I was the library director and I pretty well know everything around there. But I do like it because you can pull it up and instantly you know which precinct they need to be in. You know if they voted already. You know if there's something wrong with their address. I like that. So that's my opinion on the e-poll.
Thank you very much. Judge Minton, then Ms. Breckel, you want to come up and be ready behind Judge Minton? Ms. Breckel, you want to come up behind Judge Minton?
Sure. I don't speak a whole lot, but as an elected official, every vote counts. I had inquired with Judge McDaniel last year about being able to vote anywhere within the county, not just in your precinct. There are a lot of people when we're outside those polls working them. I have four boxes that vote for me. I spent over $200 this last election for the March election and printed four books with every vote
question real quick.
Yes, sir.
And maybe it's just I'm ignorant on this, but in early voting, anybody in any precinct comes up here and can vote. And at the same time, we have early voting in Lumberton and Silsby and places like that where anybody can go to those places and vote. What's the difference?
Well, then you'd have to print 19 or 20 different sets of every precinct and put them at every location, whereas on when we're doing it early, you only have to have one set here and then one set in Lumberton.
Well, I understand that, but what I'm understanding about what he's saying and what the concern is a person can vote here and then without the internet hookup and go somewhere else and make a, you know, cast a vote.
It's all at one location.
We still have paper.
You can verify they only go out here, they go here and Sour Lake on the same day.
Yeah, well, that's why I wasn't understanding that, but.
Yeah, I mean, you're in early voting, how many early voting locations do you have? Don't you download the result, the list?
Every afternoon.
So every afternoon she downloads the list. You can have them connected during early voting where it does it in real time. Again, that's a county preference, what y'all, whatever y'all want to do. Why the law allows early voting, and you can have as many polling places in early voting where you can vote any ballot,
just, we just go by what the, county clerk recommends to the court. So, basically, she makes a recommendation on the polling locations, or if there's any recommendation for, consolidating precincts and what have you, we talk about that and then vote on it, before the election.
Main thing is.
But we don't actually select those locations, or at least we have not done that in the past, Commissioners.
But you have to approve them.
Yes, we approve, she submits it to the court and we approve it, yes, ma'am.
Accessibility is one of the biggest key priorities, did they have enough parking, did they have enough place to set up, is it, if you can, is it central within the precinct? And, that's the main thing.
Is there a 25-mile rule or something like that?
No, just, you know your precinct, you pretty much know who's voting, and you try to make it really accessible for those who are gonna come out and vote, I mean, you know, obviously for everybody, but,
And I think that should be, I know we all get aggravated at voters who are not, who don't eat, sleep, and drink elections like we all do. I think we should always be mindful that it's our jobs as election officials to make the voting experience as pleasant as possible, even if they are in the wrong polling location. We don't need to condemn them or make fun of them, we just need to help them get to the proper polling location. And I think with, you know, I don't know what Glenda or our tax office could do about more education in that regard or public awareness. I'm not exactly sure what that would be, I haven't looked at that. But I do think it's something that we all, I mean, barely, all we do is post the notice of the election, list the polling locations. So, I don't know, that's just something I'm throwing out there that, you know, if anybody else had something, some other input they might want to present to the court, I think it's important because we all know all this crap. But a voter that just votes once a year, they may vote early in the primary election, then they vote on election day in the general election.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in their minds, they've gone to work 50,000 times trying to pay their bills, you know, ordinary things that working people do. They're just trying to go vote, and I think it's our county's responsibility. I noticed something about election commission that I'm not aware of that we have that actually exists. But I think that would be something that if we have an active election commission, that we could meet in that commission. Can't mind others that are deeply involved in the election process to come up with ideas of where we could educate the public more. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Bradford. Yes, sir, you want to come up?
I've seen it, I saw it.
Yes, sir.
Tony Roberts from Sour Lake.
Yes, sir.
I understand what she's saying about getting more information out there. I think there can be some more information provided. We also have to remember we're talking about adults and citizens. And there's some personal responsibility that comes out, that goes with you finding out. There's some personal responsibility that goes with voting and learning and knowing where you go vote. There could be more information provided, but as a citizen, it is your responsibility to find out where you're voting. And it can be found out. I've done it personally. I've called your county clerk's office and say, hey, this is where I live, where do I vote? And they're happy to tell me, but more information can be provided, but let's remember personal responsibility. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have an extra comment on what you just said, sir. That's excellent advice. We all do have that responsibility as voters, but as people that administer the elections, we also have a responsibility to make it as easy and accessible as possible, I believe.
The phone call was quite easy at LA.
Ms. Perez. There's not just a county Facebook page. I have a county judge Facebook page.
Okay. Would it be possible for the county, it doesn't matter who, to make a Facebook page where it would tie them into
the addresses?
What precinct, where the polling places are. Also put a link on there to am I the registered voter that the state has on their website.
Yeah.
I know that Hardin County has a website. It's not the greatest. It
I think this was productive. I hope that y'all do as well. I want to thank everybody for coming today and being open with comments and concerns about elections. Commissioner, did you have something?
I just had a comment. A question was asked a while ago, and I may have misunderstood it, but Glenda does not set the voting precincts. Glenda brings to the commissioner's court if a voting spot is changed. Voting precincts are set when redistricting happens. We have a firm out of Austin that handles this. It takes it through the Justice Department and all the approvals we have to have. They set commissioner's precincts, JP precincts, and voting precincts boundaries.
I think they were talking about public places, though.
Yeah, public places.
Yeah.
Yeah. Glenda makes recommendations to the court, like Chris said, based on accessibility and complaints we've had and availability, you know, things like this. But there is a process that goes through on all these voting precincts. That's where you can't just create whatever you want to.
Yeah, and I think you've had some good ideas on some other locations, but it just didn't work out where they would let us come there. So we can only go where we're accepted. And some people have started charging for us to use
the
facility.
They all charge just about.
And making requirements for insurance.
Yes, right.
And handicap.
Right.
And there was movement not too long ago that some people that I got calls, they had objected to voting taking place at churches. If we didn't vote at churches, we'd really have to scramble around for voting places.
Yeah, most places.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Roberts, you have anything?
I learned how to vote when I was in junior high school. I'm sure a lot of people my age back in the day, they used to bring the voting machines to the schools, and we actually voted. We voted for whatever, the homecoming queen, whatever. But we learned to vote in school. You learn and when you were in class and in government class, you learned to vote. And you know, you're talking about trying to teach the adults to vote. They should have learned in schools, and maybe our schools need to start teaching them more. I don't know if they're still doing that. But
I don't think they're
where to vote, and I understand that. But you know, if people just need to learn, and it goes back to what he was saying. There is a personal responsibility amongst people to vote. You know to vote. I taught my kids. I'm sure we have, all of us in this room. We all are voters. We know this. We teach our families. We talk to our peers and our people about voting. But there's people that just don't even think about it, you know. That's just my comment. And I think if you want to start teaching early. You know, this is how you vote. This is why you vote. You know, you got to get back to the basic.
I think a lot of it comes from home and from the churches.
Yeah. Thank you, Commissioner. Mr. Kirkendall?
I just want to say thank you to everybody who works the polling places. I know it's not an easy job. Pay is overwhelming. I know you can go out and maybe get a hamburger off of what you make. But anyway, I want to say thank you because I know it's stressful. I know it's tedious. I know that trying to work with machines and the clerk's office does a good job of putting it all together and then having to respond to more than one event during it on election day. I know that's challenging. But man, thank y'all so much for your time, for your efforts, for everything that you put in. To make it happen, it is a constitutional duty of a county to provide elections, and we could not do it without y'all.
Absolutely.
We absolutely could not, so thank you so much.
Mr. Cooper?
Nothing.
Ms. Perez had her hand raised a second ago.
I did have one
thought.
I have two more cents. I'm
all right.
Such a rich Republican.
Judges still have jobs. Some are retired. One of the issues with some of us having jobs is we're ending up having to take 3 days off of our real jobs to
So you can't leave those ballots there. They leave the machines, they can leave the machines.
If we could require
and have either the election judge or the alternate judge meet up there, have a commitment from them that yes, they've got to meet up there. Instead of having to drive up to the courthouse, which courthouse is centrally located, but it's a long way from the west end of the county and the south end of the county.
That wouldn't be a problem, as long as someone's.
We can make that commitment.
Yeah, and if it's not, then the driver will just have to take it back with him.
Sure.
And then that judge can drive all the way to the courthouse.
Up here and get everything.
That's right.
Get the machines and everything, yes.
That's fine.
Because he has a time that he's going to deliver, and it's at an approximate time, so.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't have a problem with that.
Okay.
Thank you.
And that would be secure, that would be no problem with security doing it that way?
If that judge is there.
Okay.
We come up here and get the ballots anyway.
Right, and take them with you.
So we lock them in our, usually in our homes, but don't tell anybody.
The ballots
are locked in a secure case, and we do protect the case, so that it's not vandalized or anything like that.
Okay.
Yes, it usually is secure, yes.
Thank you, Ms. Perez.
I have one more.
Mr. Batman, did you have anything further?
Good.
Ms. Breckel? Anybody else? Yes, ma'am, Ms. Cleveland. Would you please? We'd appreciate it.
We haven't addressed this, and I don't know how to address this. The people, I've been an election judge ever since Ann Richards, when she left and I became.
Who's that?
Huh?
No, I'm kidding.
It's a long time, I'm the oldest one probably in the room. But anyway, here's the problem. It's getting harder and harder to find people that are experienced or even can think what to help.
Yeah.
It's just the last two elections, I don't know. How do y'all have any idea what we can do? Do we need to advertise in the paper or try? I think there's probably a good many people in Hardin County that's capable of working an election. But it's everybody here probably knows when they're election judge, when it's time for us to get our. And Glenda tells us how many people, or Robin tells us how many people we can have to work with us, and then we can't find anybody, and it's like nobody wants to work the election. So that part of my and then I get people up there that I would be better off if they weren't working the election.
I really would.
I mean, it's been messed. The last two times have really been messed up.
Yes, ma'am.
Because of what someone did. And so I don't know if anybody has. I want everybody just to think on this and try to figure out what we can do to overcome this problem. You know, I don't know if we need to start a big advertising campaign or where we get the money, but at some point we need to ask people. You know, this is not bad. I mean, I always say I'm retiring and I don't, and I keep going because. But it's worth it when you go home that night and you're so tired, but you feel like you've done something for your county.
Right.
So maybe, I don't know if anybody has
motion by Commissioner Kirkendall and a second by Commissioner Cooper. All in favor?
Aye.
Well, thank y'all again for spending your